Hi everybody, this is Dr. A. We're going to do a few simple lab math reviews. I'm going to look at solutions in this video. Okay, so the expression of solution concentration. So solutions are made up of a mixture of substances. So making up a solution usually involves two main parts, the substance that's being dissolved, the solute, and then the substance into which the solute is being dissolved, and that is the solvent, and together they make a solution. A very practical example would be dissolving some sugar in water. So in that case, the sugar is a solute and you are adding it to the water, which is the solvent. Okay, in working with solutions, it is necessary to know or to be able to measure the relative amounts of the substance in the solution, and so that's known as a concentration of the solution. So if we go back to our sugar and water example, it would be, for example, you have a quart of water. How much sugar are you adding to it? Are you adding a quart of a cup of sugar, or are you adding 2 cups of sugar? The concentration of sugar is going to be very different between those two scenarios, between a quarter of a cup and 2 cups, if you put it in 1 quart. And so the concentration is the amount of one substance relative to the amounts of the other substance in the solution. So in our example, it would be the amount of sugar compared to the amount of water. Okay, so there's a lot of different ways to express that depending on the two components, the solute and the solvent. So you have the weight or mass of solute per volume of solution. So that's designated as W over V. And it's the number of grams of a solute in 100 mils of a solution. And so that implies a liquid, right? Something that is got a volume that is liquid. So a concentration, for example, milligrams per milliliter or per deciliter, whatever, that's a concentration of a lot of different things that we measure in blood. We use that particular concentration. Designation. For example, 10% of sodium chloride by weight over volume, W over V in parentheses next to it, is an aqueous solution of 10 grams of sodium chloride in every 100 ml of solution. So 10 grams of salt in every 100 ml of maybe water. You can also express it as the weight of the solute per the weight of the solution. So that's W over W. It's the number of grams of solute in 100 grams of solution. So in our example, 6% potassium hydroxide, W over W, is a solution with 6 grams of potassium hydroxide in 100 grams of solution. The volume of solute per the volume of the solution, so that's V over W, is the number of mils of solute in 100 mL of solution. 70% ethanol, volume over volume, is 70 mils of ethanol in 100 mL of solution. So of that 100 mL that you measure, 70 mL of it, 70% of it is ethanol, and the rest is something else. Could be a different alcohol, could be water, something else. You can also express it as percents, so that's parts per 100 parts. You often see that if you get instructions to make, for example, a 10% bleach solution or a 25% bleach solution, and that just means that you need to mix 10 parts of bleach to 90 parts of your diluent, which is usually water, and so that would make 100 parts total. And so if you use mil, it could be 10 mils of bleach and 90 mils of water, and you would get 100 mils of 10% bleach solution. It's 10% because it's 10 mil of bleach and 100 milliliters of the total of the solution. And so that 10 over 100, that's 10%, right? So next, we have molality. The molality is the number of moles of a solute per kilogram of solvent. And the molarity is the gram molecular mass or weight of a compound per liter of a solution. So one's kilogram, the other one's liter. One is the number of moles, the other one is the weight or the gram molecular mass. And so moving on, a little bit more practical, the osmolality is the number of osmoles of solute per kilogram of solvent. So an osmole is a unit of measurement that describes the number of moles of a compound that contributes to the osmotic pressure of a chemical solution. When we measure osmolality in the lab, we basically look into see how concentrated the serum or urine is. So we can do serum osmolality and urine osmolality. The molecules that contribute the most to osmolality are going to be things like glucose, sodium, urea, nitrogen, etc. So if a patient had an elevated glucose and an elevated urea nitrogen in their serum, you would expect them to have a higher osmolality reading than a patient that have normal glucose concentration and normal urea nitrogen concentration. The osmolarity is the number of osmoles of solute per liter of solution. So it's just a little bit different calculation, but the one that's used in the lab is the osmolality, and it's reported in milliosmoles per kilogram. The titer is an expression of the concentration of antibody in serum. So you will see like 1/2, 1/4, 1/8, 1/16, 1/32, 1/64, etc. The higher that bottom number is, so the bigger that bottom number is basically the more dilute the assay had to be to still get a positive reading. So that means there's a lot of antibodies in the serum. So a titer of 1/64 is a lot more antibodies in the serum than a 1/4 titer. 1/4 is less. And then proportions and ratios. So proportions are used to determine a quantity from a given ratio. And a ratio is an amount of something compared to an amount of something else. And so ratios always describe a relative amount. So there's at least two values that are involved. We see those used in instructions for dilutions where, for example, like we just did with the bleach, to make a 10% bleach, you were going to mix 10 parts of bleach with 90 parts of water. Well, that's a ratio. That's 10 to 90 makes a total of 100 and 100 mil, 10, you know, if we did those 10 mils of bleach, 90 mils of water, you could write 10:90. And it's mils and mils, the same unit on both sides. And that would be, that's your ratio of what you mix in with what to get your 10% bleach solution. So one that's often seen is a 1:9 ratio. So where you mix one part of serum to 9 parts of water. What the part is, you get to determine depending on how much serum you have. So maybe you don't have a lot. You use only 100 microliter of serum, then you would use 900 microliter of the water, and that makes a 1/10 dilution. We're going to get more into dilutions in the next video. So, but whenever you set up a ratio and proportion problem, the two ratios that are compared have to be written in the same order. So if we're writing serum to water, then we keep it in that order, right? And they must be in the same units. So you can't compare milliliters and liters or milligrams and grams or whatever. You have to have them all in the same units. So sometimes there's some conversions that might be involved there. And then the concentration of solutions to relate different concentrations of solutions that contain the same amount of a substance or a solute, a basic relationship or ratio is used. So this is the relationship. The volume of one solution, V1, times the concentration of that solution, C1, equals the volume of the second solution times the concentration of the second solution. Once you set that up as a formula, if you know any of the three of the values, you can figure out the fourth one. And this relationship shows that when a solution is diluted, the volume is increased as the concentration is decreased. But the total amount of substance remains unchanged. So, for example, if I had 1 mL of serum that had a concentration of 500 milligrams per deal of glucose, okay, and maybe that was too high for my machine to read and I needed to dilute it, and so to that 1 mL, that has a concentration of 500 milligrams per DL of glucose, I add another mil of water. Okay, so now we have 2 mils, but in that 2 mils, my concentration of glucose is 250. And so, I would expect it to be 250. How did I figure that out? Well, you line it up like this and you solve for C2. C2 becomes an XD unknown that you solve for. It's with numbers this easy, it's kind of very easy to see the relationship. So I found, I used O so you guys could see it. And so we would do that. Usually what happens is, in these types of scenario is, we know it's maybe above 500 or something. And so we dilute it to get an accurate reading. And then you multiply this back by the dilution factor. And we're going to talk about that again in the dilutions video. And you can get what the original concentration was at the beginning. So if we did a 1/2 dilution. So the dilution factor is 2. If you multiply 250 back by 2, you get 500. And so you go back at your original concentration. So there are a couple of types of solutions that are commonly used in the lab. The standard solution. So a standard is one that contains a known exact amount of a substance being measured. And then working standards can be prepared from the stock standard solution. And they're often used in spectrophotometry. And how to use the spectrophotometry is to set a calibration curve. And so the way they do, so again, let's just take glucose as a standard, for example, and maybe your standard solution is 200 milligrams per deciliter of glucose in your standard. And you're gonna make some working standards off of that. So maybe you take it and you take a portion of it and add an equal portion of water, so you make a 1/2 dilution. And now, because you started with 200 and you diluted it by half, now you have in that tube a standard of 100 milligrams per deciliter. And then if you dilute this one by half, in your next tube you have a standard of 50 milligrams per deciliter. And if you dilute that one by half in another tube, you'd have a standard of 25 milligrams per deciliter. And then what you can do is you take your tube that has 25, tube that has 50, your tube that has 100, and your tube that has 200, and you read them in the spectrophotometer and get the absorbance for each of it, and then you can plot in a graph the absorbance versus the concentration, get yourself a calibration line going, and you can get the function line and all that, and from that then you can when you have an unknown, a sample, you're trying to find out, determine the glucose value of the sample. Well, it gets an absorbance reading, and from the absorbance reading and the standards that were set, it deduces what the concentration is in that sample. So that's how standards are used in the lab, or one way anyway, setting calibration curves. And then the blank solution is a solution that contains reagents that are used in a procedure, but it does not contain that substance to be measured. It's a way to zero out a spectrophotometer to say, this is everything without a reaction happening. And so this is the base color, because a lot of chemical reactions are changes in color. And so this is the base color that would be the blank. And then any change from there, they can change measure the change in absorbance, and then that it helps to have a more accurate measurement. So there are a lot of procedures where you have to blank the spectrophotometer with a blank solution. And depending on the procedure, that blank solution could just be distilled water, or the blank solution could be your reagent without your sample in it. So anyway, that's an overview of solutions. I appreciate your attention, and more to come in the next video.